exams that have been cancelled. So I will just, we'll just start in a minute. In the meantime, I would like to tell you that our academy, Banjara Academy, it's open from Monday to Saturday, 9 to 5:30, and you're most welcome to come for any type of counseling need. So today we will be discussing about the students, you know, their emotions and what is going on in their mind, you know, and Dr. Ali will be taking us you know, through the various emotions, and you can also feel free and discuss you know, whatever any type of anxieties, disappointments that you could be going through as a student, as parents, as well as you know, even teachers. So let us look at those. So basically, board exams, you know, the moment board exams start, the year starts, everybody's talking about it, preparation happens, all other activities stop, and so much of effort and time goes into it. This year has been very different for almost, you know, this generation. I mean, this is the first time that board exams have been initially postponed. So after the pre-boards, everybody was preparing, and suddenly there was a lockdown. And you know, wondering when will the board exams be and all that, and there was a lot of uncertainty. So students were going through all types of emotions, like there was anxiety, disappointment. When is it going to be? Should we study or not? Should we pause? So many stopped studying, and then they said, okay, July the board exams are going to start. Again, July, come July, and you know, now it says it's cancelled. So what happens to that 1 year of effort that has gone into it from the student's point of view? Parents were anxious, teachers, you know, were also anxious and waiting for results. So now what next? So exams cancelled, what next? This is the topic that we'll be discussing today. In case you can please share your comments and your, you know, all your anxiety, whatever it is, please share it, and Dr. Ali will be addressing. And just to tell you that counseling, you know, needs, if at all you feel you need to come here and speak with us, you know, counseling is absolutely free at our academy. So once again, welcome you all, and to discuss the topic, we have Dr. Ali on the topic, exams cancelled, what next?
Very good morning. Exams, no exams. Exams, no exams. Exams postponed, exams cancelled. Get your marks by what you have done earlier, appear for the exams, hold on. When will re-exam take place? Nobody can say. Hoping, if not July, August. What's going to happen in August? Nobody knows. This is what has been happening this year, as Seema was just now telling you, that we have been going through a lot of topsy-turvy. We did have earlier occasions, if you recollect, when board exams would start and maybe some paper would be leaked out, and that paper had to be redone, and that itself was such a irritation. Students would say, what, we have given this blessed exam, and now just because of some stupid fellow who leaked out the paper, I have to reappear for it when I was already through with my exam and I was relaxing and things like that. But that's how life was, and they went on. This time the situation was very, very, very different. And let me just quickly, you know, list out what happened to the different boards. SSLC exams had not started. Students were still preparing when the lockdown came in. I truly admire and appreciate and thank the government of Karnataka that they took this bold step and said that we are going through with the SSLC exams, which have started on 25th June. Four papers are already over, only the languages now remain. And please note that not a single child who went for the exam contracted COVID in the examination hall. There was a very small number of children who had to give up the exam because they tested positive, but they tested positive at home, outside. And then when they came for the exam and they were found to be positive, they were told that no, you don't appear now, you appear in the supplementary, which is going to happen after a month, then you will be treated as fresh candidates. So here is this wonderful success story that we are actually going through these exams. 8 lakh students will have the pleasure of being through with their exams during this week, and they can look forward to getting admission, going on for higher studies and things of that sort. I think, you know, the government has done a wonderful job for them. In the same way, PUC, the exam, second PUC board exams in Karnataka state were almost completed. Only the English paper was left over. Here again, the government rose to the occasion, and we actually had the English paper about 10 days back. Again, 3.5 lakh students appeared for it. Not a single case where a child went for the exam and came back with the virus. So all of them safely completed it. We are expecting the results within few days. And once the result comes, second PUC students of Karnataka will be able to move on for their higher studies. But what happened with the other boards, that is mainly the CBSE board and the ICSE board? They had also started with their exam. Luckily, 10th CBSE was almost over, but 12th CBSE was to go through. ICSE 10th standard, the exams were incomplete and they had to go through, and all these students were left in a limbo. Now here the main thing is that these are all India boards, they are not restricted to particular states. So whatever decision has to be taken at an all India level. Anyway, for whatever it is worth, the authorities decided that yes, in July we will have these exams. And that also came in very recently, because 2 months, 2.5 months, there was no announcement of the dates, and all these students were sitting with a lot of anxiety, tension, whatever you want to call it. Finally, the government announced the dates. Obviously, it was fait accompli. They had to give, because like Seema told you a few minutes back, right from the time when they came into that year where the board exam is held, everybody was down there head, you know, saying that this year is board exams, it's not like the other years, you have to give up on all your leisure activities, hobbies, friends, this, that, and you have to prepare for the board exams. And after doing all that, when these exams are postponed, so when the new date was announced, a lot of students were very happy and they said, okay, for whatever it's worth, we will give. Some of them did have anxiety. We were talking to such students who said that, you know, because of the lockdown for so many days, I have lost touch with academics. Not even a simple thing like, you know, going for some coaching class or sitting and doing some common studies. All that had come to an end, and I was told to sit at home and study for an exam of which the date had not been announced. So a lot of them lost out on that, and they were very upset and whatever it is. Anyway, they started preparing the moment the dates were given. And then suddenly, the exams have been postponed. Not only have they been postponed, in certain cases they have been told that you have the option of going by whatever marks you have scored in the tests and the preparatories and whatever term exams and all that. Based on that, we can take you forward. But if you do want to give the exam, we are planning to go ahead. That's what the government's latest announcement is, that we are planning to go ahead. Again, they have not announced the date, but they have said that we are planning to go ahead. So when that exam is held, you have an opportunity. Those of you who did not score well in the unit tests and terminals and all that have an opportunity to give this board exam and improve on their marks. When? We don't know. In the case of Karnataka, there is a dilemma. Some states where no exams have taken place, all the 10th and 12th standard students are awaiting for the exam. So they come under one blanket. In the state of Karnataka and maybe one or two other states, there is a dichotomy. As I told you, there are 3.5 lakh students who have already completed their second PUC. The equivalent is intermediate in other states, or 12th standard boards. In 10th standard, SSLC exams are going on right now. unless there is a grave emergency to stop them, it looks quite likely that it will go through smoothly, and in the next 3-4 days the exams will be over. So we have these two categories of students. Today primarily I wanted to address the students and parents of those whose exams have been postponed, because the first thing that comes to their mind is that I have studied so long, now I have been let down again. Now again I will have to keep studying. Right now I will have to keep studying without even knowing when the exam is there. And then suddenly we don't know when they will exam, how announce the dates of the exam, how much time period they will give us, and how much of last minute studies we have to do. The other thing is those students who have been given this choice, it's really a Hobson's choice, you know. For a student, it's so difficult to take, even for a parent for that matter, it's so difficult to take that risk of saying, do I go by my internal marks or do I appear for the board exam or whatever it is. So there is this dilemma also which a lot of them are facing. The other thing is that very soon, let's say the PUC results are just around the corner, because there was only this English paper which was left over, and that is also over 10 days back. So any day now we can expect that the second PUC results will be announced. Now what happens to those who are in the 12th standard CBSE or the ISE students? They haven't even given the exam, forget about the results. Now if all the seats in the good colleges for the degree exams are going to be filled up by students from second PUC, where do we stand? This is another question which a lot of students and parents have been asking us. Of course we have no answer because we can't talk on behalf of the government. But we can definitely help you, guide you how to prepare well for the future regardless of anything that is happening. The first thing is that I'm sure you will all accept that exams have been given too much importance in our education system. So much so that I had to be very embarrassed when I asked one of the Westerners, eminent educator from the West who had come, and I had asked him, what do you think of the Indian education system? And he looked at me, smiled and said, Indian education system, I don't know much about it, but you have an excellent examination system. We talk in India about nothing except exams. It was quite embarrassing to have an outsider tell us that, but at the same time what he was saying was not very far from the truth. Our focus has always been on exams. Learning, educating yourself has somehow been in the background, it has been secondary, and that trend has been increasing in the last few years. The amount of coaching that is being given, the amount of preparation for competitive exams has now become 10 times more important than the regular studies and the regular board exams. So somewhere our whole system has moved on to that, which you can say a blessing in disguise, this lockdown has helped us to stop and think. Otherwise we were like a juggernaut which was going on. I have to get into IIT, I have to get into MBBS through NEET and all that. Other than that, people were not talking anything at all. So in a way that has been a blessing in disguise, that we can now sit up and at least think, is this examination the end all and be all of life? Those extra percentage marks or that rank which gets me admission into one of the top notch colleges, is that everything? No, it is not. If I am from CBSE or ISE and I am going to lose out because PUC students have done their exams and they are getting their results before me, does it mean that I will not have as good a future as they have? No, that is not true. If we start looking at the examinations of life rather than the board examinations about which we are talking right now, the examinations of life continue almost on a day-to-day, week-to-week, month-year, continuous. As long as there is life, there are examinations of life. And I think this lockdown has given us a wonderful input into understanding what are the type of examinations of life that we have to face. you complete your 10th or 12th standard, you go into a good professional course or whatever it is, you get your degree, maybe even a postgraduate degree or whatever, everything you get, you start working. And one fine day your boss comes and says that, sorry, you are redundant, just leave, we don't need you. And you, here you are thinking that, you know, last month or last year I had got that employee of the month award and I am so indispensable and this and that. And before you know it, you are out. That is reality. The same day, you don't lose your job, but you are trying to get one of the biggest contracts for your organization. And everything seems to be going positive. You put in all your efforts. You prepared immensely. You're giving him the best of bargain. You're doing, leaving no stone unturned to make sure that you give a good deal to your customer and get a good contract from him. And suddenly you realize that somebody has played dirty, he has done some underhand things and he has taken away your contract. It is like somebody who has prepared very hard for the exam, gone and put in his best efforts, but somebody else cheated in the exam and got better marks and therefore he got selected into a good institution and I got left out. Now these exams of life are going to be there throughout, as I said. It can be in the workplace, it can be with regard to your job, with regard to your organization. It can be in relationships, it can be in domestic life. It can happen anywhere. It is a simple thing of understanding that the examinations of life are part of the system. I don't need to prepare for examinations, I need to prepare for my own well-being and for my own progress. If I am doing that, even if I fail in one odd exam here and there and I have this setback and somebody cheats me, somebody takes away my job, somebody takes away my contract, or even in a relationship, you know, I've been extremely nice to somebody but that somebody cheats me in the relationship, I learn how to face it. I want you, whether you are a student or a parent, to please look into this angle of life, which, as I said, thankfully, this, the lockdown has helped us to stop and think. Otherwise, I know innumerable people who are not even willing to think about it. People were giving up 1 year after their 12th standard only to sit and take 12 hours of coaching, only to crack one particular competitive exam. Is life going to be restricted to that? No. And that is the reason why I want you to look at this. Okay, now the exam will be held, the result will come out or whatever it is. Things will move on. This is not the end of your life, this is not even the end of your education. That much I can assure you, regardless of whatever else happened, however long this COVID business takes, whatever happens, one thing I can assure you is that life is going to move on. And even your education is going to move on. Eventually, where are you headed? That is the question which I want you to please reflect on. So many students get so caught up during the board exam here that they are thinking of nothing except the classroom, the assignments, the homework, and then the after school coaching. And then the work that is being given to them, this worksheet, that assignment, the unit test, weekly test, they are so caught up in that that they forget to look at the larger picture of life. And that is what is going to be your career. Children who are now at the threshold of adulthood, the way longevity is improving, the way healthcare and nutrition is improving, they are going to be active members of society and contributing members of the economy for an average of up to 75 or 80 years of age. They are not going to retire at 55 or 60. That is an absolute truth, and I can predict that. I may not be around when you reach 75, but please remember that is a reality, and that is what the examination you need to, you know, prepare for. When I tell children, hey guys, you're going to be working till 75, they say, oh, who wants to work that long? I don't want to. I'll work hard, I'll become a CEO, I'll earn a lot of money, and at 40 years of age, I'm going to retire and go and live in my farm. You're going to have a lot of examinations in the farm also. The weather will play truant, the local politicians will disturb you, the pests will come and eat up your crop. There are going to be 100 examinations even if you have decided to, you know, quit your job and go and do farming. Okay, if you earned a lot of money and you want to sit at home at 40 years of age, probably your wife will throw you out of the house saying, I can't tolerate you 24/7. I did it in 2020 when the COVID was there. Now I'm not going to allow you to be sitting at home all the time. This is reality. So that's why I come to the point. Whatever has happened, you are disappointed, you are irritated, you are angry, you are confused. But do go out, do take this time, this is a wonderful extra time that has been given to you to think of your career. And how do you think of your career? You look at it in the long term perspective. 25 years, 27 years, 24 years, whatever the age, when you are going to finish your formal education, including maybe professional courses and post graduations or MBAs or MPhils or whatever you want to do, you will be somewhere maybe around 22, 24, 26 years of age. From there till 75, 50 years you are going to be working in your chosen profession. You better take a right choice. And the right choice should not be based on the herd mentality. Like this pandemic that they are saying that herd immunity will come in. No herd immunity comes in when it comes to choosing your career. If you follow the herd and if you say, everybody is saying software engineering is the best, so therefore I will do it, without looking inward, will I make a good software engineer? Will I enjoy 50 years of software? If you don't look into that angle and you jump into even the so-called best careers which have got the so-called good scope in it and things like that, you're going to be in deep trouble. This lockdown itself, as I told you, has been such a great lesson. There were professions which were doing exceedingly well. And people were jumping left, right and center into it. The lockdown not only wiped out the income and jobs and the organizations and all that, but it is unlikely that they will resume in the near future. So people who do not have a holding capacity of 1 year, 2 years, they will find that they are totally wiped out unless they now switch over at whatever age they are in. If they switch over now to a completely different profession. But let me tell you something. Those who got into that so-called profession which is now doing badly, because they have an interest, it matches their personality traits and matches their multiple intelligences, it matches their aptitude. Those who went in because of that will only have a minor temporary setback. They will have to make some financial sacrifices, but they will move on. And if they are 30 or 40 or even 50 today, they will again continue working for 10, 20, 30 years as that industry picks up. So that's why please look at the wider picture, the long-term aspect, spend as much of time as possible. If you're a student, do it yourself first, then take the help of your parents or your elders at home. Then talk to a few experts. Google on the net also and find out, but don't rely 100% on the information that comes through the internet, because we don't know which one is reliable. But do talk to experts, do talk to people who are professionals. If necessary, get an assessment done. Get an aptitude test done and find out what you are good at. Once you do that, then work backwards to say, I want to reach such a goal, and the vehicle which will take me to that is a degree called BTech or LLB or BArch or B Design or whatever it is. You have to work backwards into that. And even in that, if you aim for the topmost college or institute in that particular field and you don't get admission, it is not the end of the world. A top-notch institution, an institution which has that brand value as you call it, IIT, IIM, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, any of those things, they give you a little boost. But it is not necessary that just because you got admission there, you know, your career is going to be far better than the guys who could not make it to that top-notch institution. There was a student of mine who, of course, aspired for IITs and this and that. He couldn't make it there for whatever reasons. He went into a fairly reputed local engineering college, but not one of the top ones, even in the state or the city. He was happy. He studied hard. He had that aptitude and desire and ambition. He came out with a certain percentage. He applied to a Western university for higher studies. And he came to know that one candidate who is competing for that one seat for those higher studies is an IIT graduate. And he immediately gave up. He said, no way. Why will they select a student like me who comes from a mediocre engineering college when there is an IIT graduate with the same grades? He was quite shocked. He was selected over that other guy. He landed up there. Once he settled down, he met the professor who had done this selection. And he asked him, sir, that there was this guy who came from a top-notch institute of India. And instead of him, you took me. You know what the professor told him? He said, yes, I know that. I know that both of you had the same grades and the same track record. But he had better coaching, better environment. And with that better coaching and better environment and better inputs, he reached a particular standard. You had much less education. You didn't have the top-notch teachers or environment or whatever it is. And you reach the same grade. What does that prove? It shows that you are more capable. Even when you do not get the inputs and the facilities that you want, you are still capable of reaching a certain standard. That's why I selected you. Keep that in mind. So yes, aim for the best institutes, but do not think that life is going to end if you don't get into one of those, or if the PUC guys or the other people overtake you and they get admission somewhere and you don't get into that particular college in which you are interested in and things of that sort. Along with that, what I want you to do is what I've been always telling. We need to have a balance in life. We need to look at everything a little more holistically. During the time when the board exams are on your head, parents, some of you have actually stopped your child from doing anything other than studies. Don't do that. Even when the child is chatting with his friends, even when he is playing a quick game of cricket, even when he is doing something of that, listening to music or something of that sort, even that is learning. Don't forget that. So, in order to get, the real overall holistic learning, here is your opportunity. Use this opportunity. Quite a few students have been coming to us. As Seema told you, we give free counseling. Anybody can walk in, they can talk on the phone, they can send us an email if they are scared to step out. We reply it to all of them. Some of them have been asking, sir, what do I do? I'm a little, stressed out and distressed. And since I don't even know when the exam is going to be, I have no motivation to start studying. I tell them, okay, case to case basis. For example, there was this guy who took up, PCMB and wanted to do engineering or whatever it is. And he mentioned to me that he's also interested in psychology. I said, wow, here is your opportunity. Pick up the second year PUC textbook of psychology and read it. Understanding human behavior will give you an insight compared to the other guys who come into engineering with you and do engineering. You will know how to handle people. You will know human engineering. If possible, even take up a short term you know, course in psychology or something of that sort. So here you are adding on to your thing. The other thing that you can do during this time, which will be very useful to you, is if you already made up your mind, I want to get into law, I want to get into architecture, I want to get into business administration, I want to get into MBBS, whatever you have decided as your first goal, please borrow textbooks of the first year of that course and start reading them. There are two advantages. Number one, you will be sure that you are in the right place. I know of so many who take admission and then they get a shock. I never thought this is what they are going to be teaching. I am overwhelmed with that. I am not able to connect to this subject or to these textbooks. So you will know exactly what it is right now. Before you take a decision, you still have a chance to say, okay, I was very keen to take up such and such course, but now after reading the textbook, I realize that it's not all that great and I don't connect to it. So you still have an opportunity, you still have time to switch over and explore other careers. The second advantage is that when you finally do make it, in whichever college, whichever institution, but you get into that particular course which you wanted to do, you will have a head start over your classmates. You will have studied, browsed through, familiarized yourself with the textbooks which are going to be taught when the classes start. So you will have one notch above the others. You will sail through more smoothly. And this I am telling you more so because in the near future, classes are likely to be online. You know that there are certain limitations to online classes. So when you join higher studies, when you join your degree course or whatever it is, and you know that the teacher is not physically accessible to you, you will not be going to the college and sitting there and interacting with your friends and talking to the teachers, asking doubts and questions. You will be sitting at home in front of your laptop and the teacher is going to give you a lecture. There again, if you have done your homework, if you have browsed through and if you have learnt something, you will realize that you are able to understand those lectures even though they are limited to that screen of the laptop or phone or whatever you are using for it. So your learning is going to be better. These are just some of the basic tips that I wanted to give you. The last point that I want to say before we open the house for questions and debate and discussion is, what are you doing in terms of building up your life skills other than just reading about these subjects? Now that you've got a reprieve from your board exams, are you spending some time looking at it? This is one thing that we really focus on. Whenever somebody comes to us with one issue, I'm having problem with this subject or I'm having problem choosing a career, we look at that person holistically. How's your relationship with your parents? What are their expectations from you? How much are you influenced by your friends? What is the level of your self-confidence and self-esteem and things of that sort? So we look at it holistically. I want you also to do that. Just to give you an idea about how this thing goes, I requested our director, Mrs. Purnima, to maybe quickly share one or two cases that we have had lately. And you'll get an idea about what we are talking about. And then please be ready with all your questions, doubts, comments. We are going to spend the rest of the time having an open house. Over to Purnima.
Good morning, viewers. We have been having some families come down, and parents have been coming down with their young ones whose exams have got cancelled. And there has been some kind of a panic and some kind of confusion, some criticism from family members and things like that, and the near and dear ones. So this family who came in, I'd just like to share a particular case study with you, just for you to understand that, Dr. Ali was also mentioning about life skills, the importance of life skills. He was also mentioning that this is not just the only exam that is coming up our way. So life is going to be giving us a lot of exams, lot of tests, and we just need to be prepared for life in general. So moving on back to that case, so this family came in and they were very supportive, very encouraging of their child. But then because of his friends and classmates, he was a little confused that how should I be going about things. And so we just asked him that what is it that his confusion was. He mentioned that he basically wanted to do engineering purely because all his friends wanted to do it. And then when I sat down with the family members and asked them that what is it that they have in mind, they mentioned that no, we are absolutely open to anything. And then the boy was I think I can also do something else, where he was a meritorious boy, a topper and things like that. So he told, no, if something else is going to give me satisfaction and happiness, I am ready to do that. So what we did was, as Dr. Ali was just mentioning to you, in such a case, we do what is called as a holistic career assessment. So what we mean by that is, every person has got certain interests. So that is one thing. Then they also have skills to go with it. When I say skills, what I mean is this person an introvert or an extrovert, or shy to meet people, or is not a shy person but prefers to be to himself. So that is another thing that happens. And then comes the aptitude. When we say aptitude, what we mean is that what comes very naturally to you, what is a capability of yours. It's a very flair, natural flair that happens. So what we did was, we got done what is called as a career counseling. I sat down with him and asked him, what do you think are the skills that you have? And then he wrote down some things. Then I asked him, okay, what do you think are the interests that you have? Then he wrote down some things. And then he said that, no, I think about this, I'm a little confused. Yes, eventually we went ahead to do a holistic career assessment for that boy in this particular case. But there are instances, where the child may not know or the child may know. Now, if the child does not know, it is a very good idea to meet up with friends, with role models, with folks in and around, with different peer groups and from different strata. So it will help the child to understand, hey, no, you are saying you are a very brave boy, but the other day when that happened, you ended up being a little shy and then you chickened out. Oh, okay. So in unusual circumstances, I may possibly, cow down. That is a skill, you understand. And in fact, in this particular case, it turned out that boy had a excellent flair, potential in law. And he told, no, I wanted to do that also, but all my friends were telling that, hey, dude, why don't you do engineering? That's much better. That has got scope. Now, this boy did not know that careers are not chosen with scopes or jobs. They are chosen with what is your niche area. And hence, it happened that what was going to be an engineering thing, he was panicking because he had to do a lot of different things and write different exams. And he may have invested all his energies and all his intelligences in something which may not have been really his calling. So that's what we go to say, that in certain case studies, which I thought I should share with you, so that it gives you a little bit of an inkling as to our kids would have prepared with something in mind, No, I am going to do engineering only. My CET is going to suffer. My NEET is going to suffer. So maybe it's a good idea to find out what is the calling of the child. And that can happen to a very great extent when parents and, family members sit down and help the child to understand. If for some reason, it may happen in certain scenarios that possibly I'm not a much aware parent. So what do I do? So I would like to show this badge of mine. It says mental health volunteer. So we are all counselors and mental health counselors and volunteers over here. We offer free counseling. We can sit down with the parents, with the family, and we can also check whether, what was the dream of this child, what was it that, the information that the child has. I say that I want to become a mechanical engineer. Why do you want to become an engineer? No, I want to be an FM racer. No, the racer and this need not be a mechanical engineer. You're getting it? So that's how we help you all to connect one with the other. and whether this particular exam, because of it having got cancelled, may bring different emotions. You know, some of them will be very happy because they would have thought, oh my god, dude, I thought I'm going to fail, but at least with my average marks I'm going to pass. And some of them may have put in a lot of efforts by which they may now feel that I wish, why this happened, I'm a topper, and you know, I am a guy who really comes out with all flying colors, why did this happen to me? So yes, we have to take all these with grace, and we also will have to ensure that we abreast and equip our children with life skills. So what we mean by life skills is that even in such an adverse scenario, does my child, do we as a whole family have the ability to tide over this situation? So that is what we mean, that when we have life skills and we also help these children go over this whatever you can call it, uncertainty, calamity, suddenness of things that has happened, if we are prepared for such eventualities, it becomes easy for us, and it becomes easy for these children also to understand that this is a very good opportunity for them to realize that what they are good at, what their aptitude is, and what their skills are. And we are now open for questions, discussions, deliberations, clarifications, and this banner which we have put up, these are about all our books, which are very simple to read, easy to understand, and also very reasonably priced. They are available on the net. We can send you e-books. You can also come to our academy, meet us. We are fully functional. So that is one thing. And also, when Dr. Ali addresses you, you will see a banner behind him. We ensure that we put it week after week, just for you to understand that we offer free counseling at the academy. And please feel free to come down, meet us at any point of time. And Dr. Ali is here. Over to him for all the clarification that you may have.
Thank you, Purnima. Let's get down to what you want to know from my class, right? Okay, online classes are opportunities for children with learning disabilities to record it and learn at their own pace. Yes, I agree. There are always, see, all these have advantages and disadvantages. Right now, what we have to do is to follow the guidelines which is being given by the government. Right or wrong, we may agree, we may disagree, but I think as good citizens, we have to follow. So the government has laid down certain guidelines. Be prepared that they are even going to change it. Few days later, they may say, no, this is not the right thing, we will do, change it to that. It's okay, it happens in life. Like I told you, even when you grow up and you're working, you will have situations where your boss will keep changing rules or something different will happen. So we will have to take that thing. Aisha says, in the long run, ranks are not important. Our students and parents need to know that. I think somewhere deep down, we know that, but we don't actually allow that to govern our actions and our life, because we still feel that, can I do something? After all, the ranks are going to decide on that. If I don't get into a good institution, and that is where this thing comes in. Two things. One is, every career today, if you are good at it, if you are passionate, and if you are backed up with all the skills and abilities to do well and to perform and to give results in that area, if you have that in you, you can earn tons of money. Same thing with institution. There was a time when we had in our country very limited institutions. IITs used to be exclusive for engineering. All India Institute of Medical Sciences, which existed only in Delhi at that time, was something really unique and best and thing. National Institute of Design was the only institution for design, like that. But the education sector has grown miles beyond that. So there are innumerable institutions today in every field which are giving quality education. So don't worry if you don't get into the first choice of the institution, go for the second, third, whatever it is. Yes, Purnim.
Ali Anu is asking how to deal with peer pressure where friends get into prestigious colleges but not him. He feels he has given a short end of the, he has been given the short end of the stick.
Exactly, that's what I said. I would rather that you face a few disappointments and a few setbacks and hurdles now rather than later in life. As a graduate of the so-called most prestigious IIT Bombay, let me tell you that in this 30-40 years after graduating out, I have not seen that all my batchmates and classmates have had a fantastic life. Some of them have messed up their life. They got admission into the top institute, they graduated from there. But as life went on, they fell behind others. The others overtook them. Take a classic example of our, you know, Satya Nadella. He has got the topmost prestigious post of becoming the CEO of Microsoft. How many IIT graduates, how many Stanford and Harvard graduates would have loved to occupy that place? Satya Nadella overtook them, and Satya Nadella is a graduate of Manipal Institute of Technology, which 30 years back was hardly a known institution. Dr. Abdul Kalam, same thing. So many people like that. So yes, it is a big disappointment. You set your mind. And that is the reason why I always say, set your mind to your career, not to the institute. I have these people who come and say, sir, I want to be IIT, sir. I said, how can you be IIT? IIT is the name of an engineering college. So you cannot make your goal the end all and be all based on one institution or one set of institutions. If you do that right now, you will not have the same type of disappointment.
Anu asks, career counseling at Banjara Academy, how long does it take? Is it possible to do online? What's the right age grade for the same?
We prefer doing it in person because there are certain insights into the student which we get right from body language, demeanor, hesitation, so many things which we get. So given a choice, I would like to have the candidate over. It takes half a day. We take all precautions, sanitizing, putting the child exclusively separately in a room. He doesn't have to touch anybody or go close to anybody. He finishes it and goes off. But knowing the limitations and knowing that not everybody can come, including a lot of people who are not even living in Bangalore, we are offering the same process of aptitude testing online. We supervise over it from here. We need one adult, a parent or somebody, to supervise there with the child and conduct the test. We provide support from here. The same test is done sitting at home and the papers are sent to us and then we process it. I personally look into every one of them. Every report that is generated here about aptitude test is done personally by me. I spend a lot of time individually taking into account the parents' viewpoints on that, the background of the student, the family, the so many factors, and then we generate that report and we give it. And subsequently, even the counseling can be done online or through video calls or whatever it is, if the candidate cannot come. When to do it? Earliest I would recommend is when the child comes to 10th standard. That is the earliest that I would recommend. Some people want to come early. We don't say no to them, but we tell them that the aptitude may change if the child has not even come to 10th standard. And from there onwards, it goes on to any time. I do aptitude testing of people who are 10 years into their career and are unhappy with it. I do aptitude testing for people who work 35 years in a sector, retired, and say, hey, I'm fit and fine, man, but I can't go back to that sector wherever I was working. So can you suggest what I can do, what I will be good at? We do aptitude testing for them also. Yes.
Okay, Ali, Shweta is saying, Dr. Ali, thanks for the session. Although I joined a little sometime back, my son is in 8th standard and things are going regular. How do we find out what is his real focus and how do we all choose something good for him?
Yes. Two things you do. Since you don't need to take any decision regarding his career right now. So two things you need to do. Number one, show him the importance of every subject. Give him that motivation. What how is mathematics going to help you? How is biology going to help you? How is a language going to help you? How is history going to help you? Let the child understand that every subject contributes towards his well-being, his success in future. So his motivation goes up. The second thing that you do with a child who has not yet come to 10th standard is help him to explore all possible professions. You have a friend who is in the insurance sector. Let that friend sit and have a chat with your child and explain what the insurance sector does, what are the skills required to be a qualified professional in insurance and actuaries and this and that. How do you read that? What's your daily routine? What sort of work you do? What sort of people you deal with? Next day you go, you know, you meet somebody who is running, let's say, a trading business or an export business. Help him to talk. So this is the time when the child should get a lot of inputs into all the possible careers. So that is horizons widen.
Right. Aisha is saying, good morning, Dr. Ali. Thank you for arranging this talk. I have seen my students at Ahead Academy who are prepared so well for ICSE and ISC exams. But now with the cancellation of exams, some of them are worried about results and the outcome. So that's why I asked Suman of Gurukul to arrange this talk on the subject.
Yeah, that's exactly the reason what I was telling you a few minutes back. As elders, as trainers, as parents, whatever we are to these children, let us help them to explore. I do understand that they are, you know, very worried, they are disappointed, they are confused. But if we help them to see the bigger picture, which is what I've been talking about for the last 45 minutes, if you help them to look at the bigger picture, then their worry will come down to some extent. I'm not saying it will go away, and it should not go away also. Students should have some amount of anxiety and some amount of stress, which will spur them on to studying and doing well.
Right, Ali. Shailija is saying, how to address students who have no social life now and have no option but attend online classes? They are going through a phase of uncertainty.
Yeah, we are working on that. In fact, if you can join us on the Facebook webinar, which we are doing on this Saturday, we are going to talk about teaching life skills at home. There I will deal in depth about what all you can do with your children who are under this lockdown and who cannot go out and do activities, what all we can do in terms of giving them this holistic learning about life skills. And in fact, after that, we are already in the process of structuring out and formulating maybe a 10-session, you know, online program for parents, so that we can actually do some handholding and give them some practical tips regardless of the age of the child, to help them to conduct some formal, informal life skill sessions with their children, so that the child, his horizon grows and he becomes a much better human being.
So now immediately, how can we avoid such situations and help our children out? If you can give us something, because they are panicking.
Yes, the first thing is listen, listen, listen. At every occasion, at every point, maybe 5 times in a day, bring the topic back to this, connect it up and say, how do you feel? Suggest emotion. Are you angry with the system? Are you irritated? Are you frustrated? Are you losing your motivation? And once a child identifies the emotion, ask him to elaborate. The more he can keep talking about his emotion, the less he will have that confusion and frustration and things of that sort. Then, as I said, talk about his abilities, for example. Say that regardless of what happens in the education system, there were times when, you know, wars used to take place, or freedom movement of India, and even, you know, we had, for example, things like that Telangana agitation or some such times when for a whole year education institutions had shut down. Nothing happened. The good students went ahead. So nothing will happen to you also. All you need to do is to start planning so that you can go further ahead.
Yes, Ali, Aisha is saying, in the long run, ranks are not important. Our students and parents need to know that.
Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying, that while it only helps you to get admission in a good institution, and you should encourage and you should motivate your child to get into whichever the best possible institution, but let us not set a very high benchmark that I want to become IIT or something of that sort. Yes, I'm good in engineering, I've evaluated, I've assessed myself, I feel technology and engineering would be the best you know, long term career for me, and to get into that I want to get into a good engineering college. I will aim for IITs, NIT, VIT, MIT, whichever one I can get in, I will take it. I will put in a lot of hard work, and eventually, even if I don't make it to the number one or number two, even if I'm in number three or number 10, I will, with my hard work and with my connectedness to that profession, I will overtake the others.
Yes, Ali, Varsha is asking, sir, I'm in the first year of BA in performing arts, but finding it difficult to understand psychology subject. Do you think I should change my field? I'm not happy with my current course.
Yeah, I don't want to make a general statement whether you should change or not. Maybe we can talk to you. If you can get in touch with us, we will go a little deeper into understanding what your aspirations are, what your long-term goals are, and how much you are getting put off with psychology and all these things. But one thing you can do right now, if you are going to continue with this course, if you are good in performing arts and you want that to be your long-term profession, please understand that in a subject like performing arts, the behavior of human beings is extremely important. How the audience responds to particular ways in which a drama or a presentation is done. How do your, you know, people in your team, what motivates them and what makes them into a good team? This is what psychology is all about. So it is, there's no doubt about it that it is going to be extremely useful for you to study psychology. But nevertheless, since you have brought it out to that extent where it is demotivating you so much that you are even thinking of quitting the course, I think we need to have a more serious discussion. Please get in touch with us.
Ali, there's a question that, is it okay if we change our career later in life?
It is okay, but as far as possible, we should avoid. The earlier you select, the better you select, and you know, you have a head start. So you are doing well. A lot of people do change. And if you do have to make a change, it should be a change for the better, not to run away from something. I got into software engineering because everybody said that is very good scope and this. Now I'm frustrated, I'm fed up, I'm doing repetitive work, I'm stressed out. So I want to get into something else. No. I have mastered this art. I have done very well in it. I know I can continue to work. I can continue to draw a good salary. I think I am meant for better things in life than just doing coding. What are those better things? Let me slowly, systematically start exploring and find out what those things are. Once I find the right one, I will not be in a hurry. I will not take an impulsive decision. I will not run away from something. But I will definitely set this goal that whether it is 1 month, 1 year, 5 years from now, I will move on to something better.
Ali, a parent is asking that, you know, actually, sir, we are okay, but we have also spoken to our child, but our family and peers feel that we are taking it too lightly. So what do we do about it?
Yes, family, peers, neighbors, even the milkman, everybody is an expert in these things. They'll keep giving you free advice. They don't charge you anything for that, whether you want to listen to them or not. But finally, it comes down to what a lot of youngsters tell their parents and irritate them by saying, it's my life. I will decide what I want to do. So it is the life of your child. Let there be very nice, well-intentioned relatives and elders and neighbors and colleagues. Listen to all of them. See whether they make sense. Find out whether they have the background, whether they have the knowledge to talk about or give the advice that they are giving. But finally, it is you who should be taking the final decision. So with that, I think we stick to our timing. We don't want to overstretch. We started on time and let us end on time. But when I say end, it is not really the end of everything. It is just the end of this particular session, because we would like you to now go back, introspect, think whatever best you can do, and work as a team, particularly between the parents and children. Take the help of teachers wherever it is possible. Take the help of experts. And we are always there in whatever form, whenever you want. Don't hesitate. Please reach out to us. It will be a pleasure to help you. Thank you very much.
At Banjara, we surely never worry about the numbers, that is, how many have come, who has come,
But then we are very seriously seeing a trend of families and the little ones, you know. When I say little ones, I mean those whose exams have got cancelled and they have seen a totally different scenario. So it is not too easy for them, and they have been coming to us, and they have been you know, checking out what could be the alternatives. And feel free to speak to us. I also have my colleague Seema over here. So Seema and I also take care of the counseling and the career counseling part of things, and both of us we have a fabulous team over here of all our counselors. Just feel free to call us up at any point of time. We'll be more than happy to help you to tide over in case you think that, you know, you have any kind of a confusion. And over to Seema.
Yes, and also, like I always, you know, repeat that not just for, you know, counseling needs, that of course we are always open, it's free. You can also make a difference to other people's life. Look at this helping hand. See, we have a helping hand, you know, a branch or an NGO arm of ours. So we have over what 300, 400 volunteers working in various hospitals as counselors. You know, they've done our diploma here in counseling skills at Banjara Academy, and now they are volunteering in various places and always available to reach out to others. So you can also be one of the you know, volunteers of Helping Hand. Come meet us. You know, understand how this goes. You don't need a psychology background for that. So that's what I would like to say. And in fact, you can take up career, you know, you can take up counseling as a career as well. So totally up to you. You want to take it up as you know, on a voluntary basis. In fact, you know, we have our enrollments on. It's very surprising that some doctors, you know, of course they've been part of you know, our Banjara Academy and doing you know, they have done their course and all that. But also this time we are seeing many HR professionals and doctors coming up to do this course, because this course deals with the emotional aspects of life, which anybody who has a compassionate heart can, you know, learn very systematically and scientifically, and that will really help you to reach out to many, many people. So that's what we at Banjara are doing. So thank you so much on behalf of Team Banjara, and you're most welcome to call us up, write to us, and come and meet us in person. So I thank you all. Let's meet this Saturday on a very, very important topic on life skills at home, you know, and this is not just for children. So we welcome you all to attend this show as well, and let's meet 11 o'clock on Saturday. Thank you so much. See you all.